So we're towards the last part of the workshop. So we'll go through this aspects of common data service, the Power Apps flow aspects of things. So there's a couple of premises in terms of why we are doing this, what we are trying to do, right? So we have the traditional set of softwares. Those are, that the customer buys today, and then they actually go in and extend. There's only a certain set of business apps which, it's kind of worth the time and effort in terms of people investing in it and then getting the meaningful value out of that in terms of those business software. You still do have additional set of requirements, and you know this more than anybody else in this room. No customer runs with just only one software. Right? They run their business with at least a couple of those solutions. That includes the standard set of software that they go in and customize, and then they go buy certain set of SaaS applications off the shelf. But there's a whole slew of things outside of this that an IT needs that we need to still go in and solve. And between these two combinations, we're still not solving the whole thing. So the rest of them is the whole wide world. So that's the premise in terms of exactly where we are thinking of solving this need specifically for an IT organization. So you have the standard set of business software that you could go in and extend. You have off-the-shelf set of SaaS applications, but still they don't meet the 100% requirement for an IT organization. So if we were to provide something to cover, help that space, what would that be? That's the whole aspects of things. And that's where the common data service solution really comes into play. It's just not the common data service. It's the common data service in conjunction with Power BI, Power Apps, and the flow capabilities. So this is another vector that which we want you to think about. I mean, when you think about from an IT perspective, the ones on the right is always the need. I want it to be really quick. I want to be able to actually start something small, iterate over it, and perfect it over a period of time, but still have something meaningful that my IT can actually go in and provide so that the business users can actually go in and use those. And it never needs to be running against one platform because of the varied nature of requirements. It needs to be able to support the cross-platform needs. Obviously, it needs to be easy and beautiful. Nobody would use if it's not looking good. But on the other hand, as you supporting the IT, right? So the challenges are it needs to be secure. It needs to scale to the needs of the IT. It needs to be managed. It has to be well into, it has to have necessary support from an integration standpoint. It needs to be well integrated. And it needs to satisfy a certain level of compliance. Otherwise, your organizations won't be able to use depending on whatever business that you do. So a solution that we come up with, a solution that any IT comes up with, these are all the set of things. And the ones on the right and the ones on the left, not one of them is important. Both these set of characteristics are important in any application that you actually try and build. Right? So if you were to go in and do this, what are some of the requirements that you need to have? You know, a solution that allows you to actually persist information, and you can actually hydrate that fairly easily and a fairly in a quick way, that you could actually hydrate a database that comes with a predefined set of things if you were to go in and start using it right out of the box. But it also gives you a level of extensibility, but it makes it easy for you to be able to build applications on top of those. And when I say easy, it's just not from a sake of that you being able to actually do this in a month's time or, in half a year's time worth of time, right? It's basically we're talking days, we're talking hours, we're talking minutes, aspects of fast and an ability for you to be able to iterate over and build something like that. So that's the basis or the premise in terms of where we are starting with, right? With that in mind, we've started looking into offering the first of that series, which is the Common Data Service. It's a combination of a data store with an SDK that comes along with it. So it's what we refer to as a common data service. And if you were to just give a quick definition of what is in terms of words, right? I'll let it complete. Make sure you guys go through this. We'll have a quiz on this at the end of the session, right? So what is common data service? So there's a store part of it or the database part of it. So the common data service gives you an easy to provision scalable data store. And then the service part of it that gives you the security and the behavior. That's the server side runtime aspects of it. I'll talk about this as we go through those. We are a well understood entity model, right? So the data entities as a concept is something that this group is quite familiar with. If we were to provide that in a similar entity representation for you to be able to actually have a persistent store that you can actually go to. So why and what is the value of a persistent store, right? So you have different databases today in any IT solution, and why do we need to add something more, right? Why do we need to have this as a data model and a data store first, along with the app aspects of things? So we look at the store to be helping from two different perspectives. One is what we refer to as an operational data store. Very common problem in an IT space today, which is you have varied set of systems of record or systems of information that needs to be consolidated so that I could get some meaningful information about data from different systems. So if I were to go and have information from different systems, it is very easy for me to go and build custom applications. I can absolutely go and build custom application. That means I can bring data from different systems, create them, or go and read from there, and then provide a set of reports if I were to. But the model is not going to be something that which you would be able to actually scale. The idea behind this particular aspect of the store is that, you know, you have a common or a central database, if you were to think of, that has the standard set of business entities that which you normally operate with, something that you can actually extend. You can actually manage relationships. That's super important. So the process for integrity. So if you were to actually go in and build something like this that's more generic, that's pretty costly. You can actually write business logic, but it's very hard to maintain on an ongoing basis. So a data store that comes out of the box with an ability for you to be able to build business relationship honored set of entities using which you can actually bring information from different source systems, do a necessary set of cleansing for that data. So that's basically all the dedupe type stuff that what you could possibly do, and keep that clean data in that central database, and then do any kind of reporting that which you would want it to go use. So that's one aspect of it. So the operational data store concept is purely from a reporting standpoint. So information in this is read-only, if you will. Then the second category with that is, again, information coming from different systems that which we would like to actually go and do transaction processing against. That basically means you can actually do read-writes, just not for the read-only aspects of it, but you can also create transactions. So the various set of scenarios that what we intend to actually support with this. We'll talk about that as we go through in terms of what and how we are planning to actually go in and use it. With Dynamics 365, this is a significant investment that's going to help us with various sort of things around master data management, integration aspects of things. We'll talk about that as we go through. So two different aspects of stores: operational data store, transaction processing data store. The operational data store is read-only. Transaction processing store is the way as it supports the writes as well. Net-net, you have an ability to be able to actually drive analytics out of this store, if you would wear, right? And the way as how we think about this is information from this is something that you can actually utilize to measure. And the measure is basically the Power BI story. ACT, which is basically the UIs. So that's done with the applications developed on top of this. That's using Power Apps. And Automate, it's basically the workflow capabilities that's done against based on different events that happen as part of you doing the ACT through the Power Apps UI, or based off of any events that happen directly with those information against those entities done through the flow. So measure with the Power BI, ACT using Power Apps, Automate using the flow set of capabilities, based on the information that is centrally maintained using the common data model. So that is the common data service in a nutshell. When you actually create a common data model, out of the box, it comes with a predefined set of entities. And these entities are something that which you can actually go and extend, as well as you can create net new set of entities as well. So there's over 65 set of entities that comes with that are categorized under six different set of groups, if you were to. And those are what is called out here. That varies from something that's very fundamental, like, you know, all your currencies, address, and stuff, and then your organization model typically that caters towards different roles of organization and the individuals that you could actually perform. And then the purchasing aspects of it, the sales aspects of it, and then certain aspects of the CRM, which is the case management aspect. We will actually continue to invest and build more sort of standard entities out of the box. And the cool thing with this is you can also get the relevant data associated with it that you can actually go in and play with this as well. The whole data management aspects of this that comes with this is fairly straightforward, so that you should be able to maintain the data in this directly using the system, as well as the other set of capabilities that what you would normally be comfortable with, that is the Excel-based set of things, and we'll show you a glimpse of that as well as we go through. So just from a data model perspective alone, right, we actually do support the standard data export-import scenarios for the entities that what we ship out of the box. So that basically means you have an Excel-based approach for you to be able to actually populate data as well as extract data from the store. We also support the Excel add-in-based data editing experience so that you can actually maintain the data in Excel and then store it back. And you could basically look at all the data directly from the portal. You don't need another system for you to be able to actually go through and browse these entities if you were to. And we'll show you a glimpse of that as we go through the demos. So security is another important aspect of this. So this comes with its own set of security if you were to think about. And this is an aspect that what we have actually released with what is generally available now, that was actually made available as part of the November release that we did. And we'll continue to enhance in this. So what you should expect is, at an entity level, you would be able to categorize whether the entity participates in a read-only mode or in a read-write mode. We will also support field levels at a security that which you could actually define. But at a high level, it supports a role-based access control model. So you could define these set of permissions, and you could assign that to a role, and the role gets assigned to the set of users. And hence, the permissions are actually enforced from a runtime perspective. There's a very minimum set of capabilities that what we have from a lifecycle management perspective. So the environment concept is the very first in that overall series of the lifecycle management. So we now have an ocean of environment. We'll start showing you what that environment means. We'll do the demo right from in terms of creating an environment and then going through that experience. In terms of we'll actually do an environment, create a new data store, common data model store if you were to, and then look at the entities that comes by default, and then we'll go and extend that entity, and then we'll walk you through that experience today, right? But the idea is that you will start with a development type environment, and you can build applications in that. And then you can take that built application, includes both the UI aspects of things, the automation aspects of things, along with the data model, and you could actually deploy that in your test environment and then deploy that in your production type environment if you were to, and give access to the set of users within the organization so that they could go in and use the application. So we now have what we call as an admin center. We'll walk you through that as well. The admin center is a place that gives you an ability to differentiate the different types of the users, the one that which can actually create applications, the ones that can actually go in and use the application, ones who can really play the role as an administrator, who can actually create environment, manage the applications, etc. So that aspect of it is completely isolated from the app experience itself, and you will see that in action. So that,
adding to that what Manoj just said, if you know Power Apps from like maybe 6 months ago, and know it now, for example, you see there's like, for example, two roles now if you look at the admin center, right, where you can pick for this environment, this user should have this role, like an admin role or a dev role. So as Manu said, on the roadmap, we keep enhancing that. So for now, we have only limited roles and limited amount of how to define that, but we keep enhancing it as we go, actually.
The other question that I normally get with this is, what about data security? Like the table level or the entity level stuff and the field level stuff is great. What about data aspects of it? We will have the row level security in a similar way as what you have with the operations today, and then we'll also have expression-based stuff, and that's something that which we are working on in terms of how to model that and how to actually make that available. So you will have data security aspects as well that which we will support as part of this. Good. So this is just showing that same in a picture view if you were to. So the common data service database, right? And the security model supports an ability for you to be able to define the permission sets, and associating those with the security roles. That is for both the standard entities as well as something that which you would be able to do that with the custom entity. And these can be assigned to a groups or to a users, which will be honored at the runtime, right? So fairly straightforward role-based access control model, and that's what we follow in here as well.
All right.
That will actually show you the product itself. So
let me show you a little demo. So let me explain the demo first. So what I want to show you is basically shortly after sign-in. So basically, if you want to use Power Apps just today, right? You just, all you do is you go to the search engine of your choice and type Power Apps as one word. That gets you to the Power Apps page. And there you use a sign in button or sign up button. Takes probably about at max 5 minutes to sign up, and then you will get like a trial, basically a trial deployment. So Manoj explained it a little bit. So Power Apps internally syncs in tenants and in orgs, and then these orgs may have environments, right? So and a tenant has like n environments among itself or below itself. So you sign in and you get the trial experience, and you can create, I think, as a 2 or 5 environments. So, 2, exactly. So, and now what we said, we just walk you through that. So, I signed up. Let's say we started like that. And I went to the admin portal. And you see this button here on the right where I clicked new environment. And now we say, okay, this environment name is Immersion Workshop, regions United States. And if I want to use the common data service, I need to enable that. I need to say, create a database for this environment. Give all users access, obviously. And we click here. And
so while this is creating, the region is this region. If you see the dropdown in that region, it actually has a list of regions, not necessarily countries, but it's a mix of countries and regions there today. Helps us to actually determine where to actually provision you with the data model. So it, the common data models, the database that we create, we actually create them in one of those data centers in Azure. So we determine which one of those based off of the information that you provide. So we had, here's a question for a question is, we used to have a preview version of this. So if you had tried the preview version of this, we did not have the concept of environment. We did not have many of these concepts. We did not even call this common data service,
right,
for the matter, right? So there are some differences because, for example, there are some limitations that we had around the way SRV supported relationships, the way SRV supported lookups and stuff. Each database that was created, depending on which time it was created, it behaves with those characteristics, so those won't get automatically upgraded for you. Okay. So,
right. So what you commonly would need to do now, if you're an older customer like 4 months ago, right, yeah, you need to basically create a new environment. Hilariously enough, it happened to me. I ran into the same issue, right? I obviously play with this since like a few months, and I just look at my demo and say, well, why is this not working? Why is this not working? Oh, I'm working in an old environment. Ta-da! Well, many of the new features I was expecting were not there. So just if you use that thing already since a while, just create a new environment and you will have all the new features with a new database. A little bit to this UI, so Manoj mentioned briefly security. So the security setup is basically hidden below the data policy, so we will not go too much into that. But if you want to know where it is, that's where to look for it. So now there's the admin portal that is sitting here over here, and then there is the PowerApps portal. And here's basically where you create your apps from, where you model your entities, where you do import, export. And I'm going to show you these things like in just a second. So first I switch to the environment we just created. And then, so my business scenario is I have quite an elaborate library of books, and I want to just, let's say I'm like a publisher of books, and I want to keep track what are the authors and what are the editors of these books, right? So I provisioned myself like this environment, and now I'll try to create like something which reflects that. So in the common data model, I already have an entity which is called persons. So I already have half of it done for me. So all I need to do is, so I have this entity persons here already somewhere, the person. So all I need to do is create an entity called books. So let's create that. Let's just click on create new entity, give it the name, title.
So while he is typing that, right? So I think at the time when you created an environment, you selected the checkbox to say create a default database. That option is the one that enabled that common data service database that got created. And I also showed that there's about 6 different groups of 65 entities that gets created out of the box. That's the experience that you just saw. One of those entities is the person one. And the experience that what he's walking through now is to actually create a new entity and define a relationship to an existing entity and then to actually go build an app using that. Right.
Correct.
So that's the experience at what we're actually trying to go through. Go ahead.
So now I need like a field there which tells me, okay, what is my title of my book, right? And let's say that will be basically a string. And then I want this to be a required field too, because obviously there shouldn't be any book without a title, I guess. We click create, which will then create the entity for us. And then we have to basically bind this entity to our person table to reflect the editors and the authors. So yeah, so now we have the entity books here. Now we quickly add a relation, two actually. So, and this basically will bind myself to person here and allow me to enter editors and authors. Save that.
So this is the part that which I talked about in the definition of the common data model. Like it creates a store, but it's just not a simple store with disjointed set of entities. The entities, you can actually define referential integrity relationships between these entities, and they'll be enforced as well at the time of the data management.
Right. So now I just create an author. Do the same thing, save. Well, might take a little bit. So now these relations will show up in my table basically as lookups or in my app.
This group should be very familiar with the concept of field groups, right? So we have a similar concept in this aspect as well. And the default lookup, for example, should be familiar. So if a particular information participates in a relationship, you would have seen that it did not allow Christian to pick up the data type. It automatically defaulted that to a lookup type. And every time you do a lookup, you normally would like to see the ID and then the displayed value. And the ID gets written to the referenced field, and then the displayed value is what the user sees. If you have those kinds of things, and if you want to show more than one field set of information, you could add those fields in those lookup field group, and those will be used to actually, exactly the same way as what we have in the application today, you are able to actually get that similar behavior in here as well. But that said, right, so our intent is not to copy all of those things over here.
Right.
It's only the relevant ones that make sense, so that the goal is to actually build quick declarative applications with constructs that enables you to go do that.
Right.
Right? So this is one of the features which will be helpful, something that you should pay attention to.
Right. So now basically, have created these fields. Now I want to highlight your attention a little bit to this bar up here. So Manoj before mentioned the import-export. So if I would have data in there, I could export it now. Or I could import data in my new entity. I just want to populate it. And for that, I just open it in Excel. And that will allow me to add like a few records.
So while this is loading the connector applet, right? So I think the thing that what it is this is similar to the Excel add-in capabilities that what you are familiar with as well, right? So this will enable you to actually get the behaviors, like getting the same set of lookup behaviors in the spreadsheet, honoring those relationships, honoring those validations and stuff, right, as you go through the Excel experience. And then that can be synchronized back to those entities that's stored in the database.
So I just start adding a few of my books, right? Book one. And then I basically set an editor, set an author, add the next line. Let me say that. Give another editor, another author. Just do one more line. So our app is not totally without anything. And technically, obviously, you could, once you have maybe one line created, you could export that, by the way, using Excel, using the export feature. And then you could use that to mass create that. So you use export to get the first record, and that gives you the data schema. And then you can basically add more and more lines and basically use that to quickly create many more records. So now I said I'm good. I have a little bit of data. I publish this data and publish successful. And then, yeah, we should be actually good to go. We have some. Wait a second. We can check, okay, how does our data look like? And no. So we can see all our records are in here. Our references should also be in here. Yeah, so here's our editors and authors. So yeah, from that point, we are actually good to create a new app. So before I do that, I need to give myself some connections. So Power Apps uses connectors so to connect to different programs like AX, NAV, CRM, SQL Server, and so on and so on and so on. And in this case, I want to connect to the Common Data Service because there I just created my app. So I create this connector, and now I can create the app using this. So I click down here, and we go for the Studio for Web.
So there is a desktop app as well that which you can actually install, and that allows you to actually select an environment and then to go and do it. Typically, from a development perspective, I would recommend using the desktop-based ones because it gives you an ability to do debugging and stuff that's a lot more easier so that you can actually get a full view of the logs and stuff. So if you wanted to look at it from, this in conjunction with the Power BI, Power Apps, and Flow, right? So from an architecture perspective, what we are really saying is this.
let's keep continuing after lunch. Maybe we let Manoj actually go through his demo, which he prepared, and it's actually pretty nice and pretty awesome. So I really like it. It's pretty complex. So we should maybe spend a few minutes on that. And so let's meet after lunch and maybe run through the rest of the presentation and keep discussing.